is one of the world's most famous recluses, J.D. Salinger. This unique footage of the writer has never been seen before, even though journalists and fans have stalked him for the past 40 years.
In a celebrity-obsessed society, he's one of the last holdouts. The more he withdrew, the more he became an object of scrutiny, an object of pilgrimages.
Greta Garbo was right. I want to be alone. I mean, just cut yourself off. The more you're mysterious, the less people know about you, the more they want to know. That's the nature of human inquiry, isn't it?
Salinger's novel, The Catcher in the Rye, first published in 1951 and never out of print, is one of the 20th century's most influential and explosive books. Its hero, Holden Caulfield, seems to speak for all those who despair at the phoniness of the adult world, from disaffected youth to the seriously dysfunctional.
The reason I killed John Lennon was to promote the reading of J.D. Salinger's The Catcher in the Rye.
Yo! On December 8th, 1980, I was in a patrol car in the 20th Precinct, and we got a call for shots fired at 1 West 72nd Street, which is the Dakota apartment homes.
Mr. Lennon was struck several times.
He's dead. He's coming back.
Somebody yelled out that he shot John Lennon, and at that point I arrested him and took him into custody. His coat was on the ground, and I said, "Is this your coat?" And he said, "Yes, and the book is mine also." I said, "Okay, the book is yours, so I'll take the book," not knowing what the book was at the time or anything, but it was a copy of Catcher in the Rye by J.D. Salinger. But later on, Chapman wrote me from prison, telling me that Mark David Chapman basically would be the catcher in the rye, saving children by doing away with phonies.
The Lennon shooting was not the only crime to be associated with the book. When John Hinckley shot President Reagan, The Catcher in the Rye was also found amongst his possessions. To some, the book clearly conveyed a disturbing message.
It's the voice of somebody who has experienced a certain amount of torment. And it probably speaks particularly strongly to others who have experienced torment themselves.
If the body digs a body, rocking through the rye.
The Catcher in the Rye has a history of controversy. Banned in many high schools across America in the 1950s, the more the book was suppressed, the more it gained a cult following.
You know, for years, if you wanted to borrow that book in the library, you had to speak in low tones to the librarian, and she'd go to the back room and bring the book out.
It was to create a new vocabulary for teen rebels everywhere.
There are certain key words in that book. One of them is phony. There was a whole culture of people here who didn't want to be phony. In a society that, in a sense, has no other values than those of commercialism.
The book spoke to readers in an intensely personal way. And not surprisingly, they wanted to know more about its creator. But soon after it came out, Salinger disappeared completely from public life. And The Catcher in the Rye itself famously begins with a rejection of the very idea of biography.
If you really want to hear about it, the first thing you'll probably want to know is where I was born, what my lousy childhood was like, and how my parents were occupied and all before they had me, and all that David Copperfield kind of crap. But I don't feel like going into it, if you really want to know the truth.
When biographer Ian Hamilton tried to write Salinger's life, the author took legal action to prevent him quoting from letters. And Hamilton was also restricted in his ability to quote from the fiction, just as we are in the making of this film. But why has Salinger tried to deny readers any knowledge of who he was? And did we have the right to try and find out more?
If I were to listen to Salinger in my head, I would say no biography of him should be done. There should be no documentary, because he would be deeply embarrassed and incensed by it. But I do understand there is a public interest.
Nobody asked Jerry to write all these books. Nobody asked him to write Catcher in the Rye, to become world famous. Once he's done that, then one has the right to look and see what the hell brought this on. Why has this book made such a response in the world?
The Catcher in the Rye covers 48 hours in the life of 15-year-old Holden Caulfield, who's run away from Pensy Prep School and wanders the streets of New York on the verge of mental collapse. Only the innocence of his young sister, Phoebe, holds him together.
I sat down on this bench. I could hardly get my breath, and I was still sweating like a bastard. I sat there, I guess, for about an hour. Finally, what I decided I'd do, I decided I'd go away. I decided I'd never go home again, and I'd never go away to another school again. I decided I'd just see old Phoebe and sort of say goodbye to her and all.
Like Holden, Salinger was also to run away from the world. But what were they both hiding from? His early childhood appeared to have been untroubled.
I'm going to refer to him as Sonny, because all the Salinger family always called him Sonny, and I find it awkward to refer to him as Jerry or J.D., but one of the motivations I have for doing this interview is that there's been virtually nothing written about the Salinger family. And what has been written mostly are mistakes. His father, as far as I'm concerned, and that's the only way I can judge, was a wonderful man. He was jolly. He had a beautiful speaking voice. He was very intelligent. He was affectionate, warm. My aunt, Miriam, I gather that Sonny was much closer to her because he dedicated Catcher in the Rye to his mother, and she was very nice.
We'll take Manhattan.
Well, I only remember visiting them on Park Avenue, and they had a very beautiful apartment, and I thought that was a cat's meow, you know. And I would play with Sonny. We'd do the things kids do.
The safe world Salinger grew up in, the park, the zoo, and uptown Manhattan, was to be a constant theme in his work.
But after about age 12, I would say, I never saw him again.
But in his early teens, he was thrust into the harsh regime of a military academy, Valley Forge in rural Pennsylvania.
I've always had the feeling that he was just a regular guy. He mixed in well with everyone else. He seemed to be a cut above in intelligence and finesse and refinement. That was evident in just his manner.
Hey, hey, Captain Jay!
Hey, hey, Captain Jay!
Maybe his father felt that he needed more discipline, more regimentation. That's what we both hated about the school. You marched to classes, you march to your meals, you march to your dorm, which we thought was sort of absurd.
It was almost certainly in response to life at Valley Forge that the rebellious voice of Holden Caulfield began to emerge.
He was rather mature for his age and a little bit on the sarcastic side. He could be very sarcastic.
I'm the most terrific liar you ever saw in your life. It's awful. If I'm on my way to the store to buy a magazine, even, and somebody asks me where I'm going, I'm liable to say I'm going to the opera.
As editor of his class yearbook, Salinger's budding talent found early expression when he came to write the school's song, a thinly veiled parody of his real feelings about the place, which is still sung at graduation ceremonies.
I nod thy tears on this last day.
The tribute song? I'll put my tongue in my cheek on that. The tribute. We all realized at that point that he had tremendous talent. And I felt he was going to do something in the literary world, I was sure.
There's a great deal of autobiography in the personality of Holden Caulfield. And of course, when I read Catcher in the Rye, it took me literally weeks to finish it because I couldn't read more than two or three pages. And I'd break out in convulsions of laughter because I could see so much of the Valley Forge life as I observed it as a cadet in the characters. And Jerry wrote this in my yearbook, "Ta-ta to my little neighbor." And as years went on and became famous, I rather treasured this.
At the age of 19, Salinger briefly attended a nearby college, a sinus. Its yearbook revealed an old college friend who gave her name to Franny Glass, a famous Salinger character, and her personality to Holden's favorite girl in The Catcher in the Rye.
Well, I met him in 1938, and he hit the campus with a bang. We had never seen anything like Jerry before.
What was he like?
He arrived dressed like a New Yorker man about town in a Chesterfield coat with a velvet collar. He talked exactly like Holden, but a little more sophisticated. He thought he was very elegant. He was a very funny boy.
Despite a 40-year correspondence with Salinger, Francis Glassmoyer was not able to shed any light on his retreat from public life.
He was outgoing and friendly and fun, and I don't know what made him get like that.
Abandoning the college after only a few months, Salinger was now hell-bent on making it as a professional writer. It was during this period that he met Una O'Neill, daughter of the playwright Eugene O'Neill.
Well, he was smitten. He just couldn't take his eyes off her. She had a white dress, nothing fancy. She was 16. She was quite sure of herself and quite self-confident. And she wasn't impressed with Salinger, but he was impressed with her because she's Eugene O'Neill's daughter. Then he told my mother later on the phone that he was seeing her in New York City, and he hoped to sell his little short stories, make a little money, and marry her. He really wanted to marry her.
Despite Salinger's almost daily letters, to his horror, Una married the much older Charlie Chaplin.
Boy, he was furious. He hated Chaplin. Thought he was a dirty old man.
In the early 1940s, Salinger's writing career began to take off. But the most traumatic events of his life were just around the corner, as war broke out in Europe. His contemporaries were surprised when the usually skeptical Salinger put aside his writing ambitions and was now keen to join up. He wrote to Colonel Baker, head of Valley Forge, for references, hoping to get a commission.
You expect a person of his personality to have cynicism and to be not to have this loyalty and fervent love of country that he displays in his letters to General Baker. If he had said some complaints about the war, that it was unjust and terrible and so on, bordering on being a draft dodger, I wouldn't have been surprised. But I was so gratified to know that he did have this loyalty and patriotism and did want to get involved in this enormous human experience of World War II.
Salinger did manage to join the Counterintelligence Corps. But his wartime experiences may have been the thing which changed his life forever.
And he did a very dangerous job in intelligence and was a genuine hero. And I have the utmost respect and admiration for what he did then.
Working in counterintelligence, Salinger's first months in Europe allowed him time to write stories to send home, and even to meet up with the writer Ernest Hemingway in Paris. But by the autumn of 1944, as he moved across Germany, he became involved in one of the bloodiest episodes of the war.
What I understand, he was involved in the very serious and terrible combat, and he went into the Battle of the Hürtgen Forest, and that was just practically a bloodbath. And I don't know how anybody survived it. I knew some of my friends who were killed there. And J.D. Salinger survived it somehow. And so he saw the horrors and ravages of war, and he saw them firsthand. And I'm sure that had an impact on him and his attitude and outlook on life, because it was a useless battle, a battle that did not have to be fought, according to what we learned from military history later on.
Salinger was also thought by family members to have had a short-lived marriage during these months in Europe.
I seem to recall that his first marriage, which was very brief, was to a French doctor, a woman doctor, which, you know, I think it lasted a very short time.
Salinger stayed on in Europe through 1944 as the full horrors of the war began to be revealed. He wrote to a friend at this time that he was in hospital, worried that he'd be given a psychiatric discharge from the army.
Now we should really have tea, shouldn't we?
All I can think of is that he had this breakdown. Maybe all the people he saw that were slaughtered in the death camps, and then all the slaughter he saw on the battlefield. And I think he did lose his mind for a while. And maybe he never came out of it.
The little he wrote from the battlefields of Hürtgen was filled with nostalgia for the safety of his New York childhood. In one story, the main character carries the same army number as Salinger. He returns to New York on the edge of a nervous collapse. Everything reminds him of the war. Everything makes him break into tears. But the thing he says that was really terrible was the way your mind wanted to tell civilians these things. He had taken a vow to keep quiet about the war, if he ever got back alive. It seems likely that these traumas played a part in Salinger's eventual reclusiveness. On returning to New York, the charm and easy humor of his youth appeared to have evaporated, leaving the more difficult side of his personality laid bare. But his desire to write was as all-consuming as ever.
All of us were aspiring to be writers, and we would meet in the village. Jerry Salinger was one of the members of the poker group. He was not highly rated because he was very dour. Never had anything nice to say about anything. And consistently won, which didn't endear him either. After the poker games, we would always sit in a booth and have a couple of beers and talk. Salinger would discuss whatever books were current at that time. And you must remember that writing then was Ernest Hemingway, John Steinbeck, Dorothy Parker. It was a pretty rich time. Faulkner was then in his flower. And Salinger's thesis, if I can call it that, that went through everything he had to say was that these were all really second-rate writers, that there was really only one writer before him, and that's Herman Melville. And between Melville and Salinger, there was a desert.
Perhaps the only place where Salinger felt at home during this period was the New Yorker magazine, which was now eager for his stories.
The culture of the New Yorker was very much like the culture I think he describes in his story, Zoe. We were all freaks, and perhaps sprinkled among us freaks were geniuses, and we did not fit into the world at all, at least the American world at that time, as we perceived it, a consumer society. On the other hand, the problem that comes up in his story, Zoe, is what do you do if you don't fit in and you have artistic temperament?
It appears that after the war, Salinger was finding it harder to fit into the world around him and beginning to search for ways of withdrawing from it. In the late 1940s, he rented a cabin in Connecticut from the Brown family, and we trace their son, Barry, who was 11 at the time and is now living in Los Angeles.
All I knew was one day this guy showed up in this incredible four-wheel drive thing with flapping curtains, and he was a tall, skinny guy and had this tremendous dog in the back. That's what interested me. And he said he brought the dog back from the war, and it was black. And I thought that was the greatest thing in the world. And my parents moved him into the studio house, and that's where he lived. And immediately, of course, I went over banging on the door and learned his name was Jerry. And my mother told me that he was a writer and I should leave him alone, and that he'd had some stories in the New Yorker. Well, of course, I knew what the New Yorker was. My dad read that all the time. And so I had kind of an awe of the man. And I didn't get in there much. He would open the door, he'd come out with the dog, and we'd walk up the street.
If a body digs a body, rocking through the rhyme.
The book, which Salinger had been working on in the studio, was The Catcher in the Rye, which came out in 1951 and spoke to American youth as no other work of fiction had before. Now a successful author in his 30s, it seems Salinger still felt most comfortable returning to the world of adolescence. Like the millions who came after him, Barry Brown was to identify closely with the book and its personal vision.
The voice of that boy who's going mad, obviously, having a breakdown, was my voice, and obviously the voice of thousands, maybe half the population's voice. I was the victim of a very abusive, disturbed childhood that looked on the surface quite beautiful, but underneath I was worse off than Holden and probably on a borderline as bad as Holden, ready to kill myself. So my sister too. In the midst of this walks a guy who's as crazy as we were in his 20s, late 20s. And when we would talk, it was like I was talking to myself. Here was an adult who spoke to me like Holden. In fact, for years, I thought I was Holden, that he'd written the book about me. Well, of course, it's about him. But I think that's the power of the book. It speaks to all these crazy, disenfranchised kids.
I mean, if they're running and they don't look where they're going, I have to come out from somewhere and catch them. That's all I do all day. I'd just be the catcher in the rye and all. I know it's crazy, but that's the only thing I'd really like to be.
He was always attracted to younger people. It's interesting, most of his friendships are with young women.
Well, he just thought they were so real and honest. I think he admired their honesty. And and Esme with Love and Squalor. Remember, he loved that little girl because she seemed so real and fun and cute. It's just hard to pinpoint, but he certainly had a soft spot for little girls, but in a nice way.
Whatever the causes of Salinger's discomfort with the world, he found his retreat in innocence. The innocence of youth, which he returns to again and again in his fiction, and the simple rural existence, the cabin in the woods. The same vision haunts Holden Caulfield.
I'd build me a little cabin somewhere with the dough I made and live there for the rest of my life. I'd build it right near the woods, but not right in them because I want it to be as sunny as hell all the time. I'd cook all my own food, and later on, if I wanted to get married or something, I'd meet this beautiful girl that was also a deaf mute, and we'd get married. She'd come and live in my cabin with me, and if she wanted to say anything to me, she'd have to write it on a goddamn piece of paper.
Now, as the catcher in the rye threatened to make him an international celebrity, he found the simple community he was looking for in Cornish, New Hampshire. It was to become his home until the present day. We arrived there well aware that the community has become very protective of their reluctant celebrity.
I'm not going to tell you. The basic rule in Cornish is anybody that knows him appreciates his privacy. Most of us know where he lives. And if you knew him, you'd know where he lived, and you wouldn't be asking us. And that's kind of the general stand.
No one around here will tell you. Sorry about that.
He didn't retreat all at once. First he came up to that farmhouse, had to chop his own wood, there was no running water. And that was the time when he was fun with the kids from Windsor High School, and they were coming over to his house and playing phonograph records, so he was taking them out to Malton to the ball games, the Windsor ball games.
Again, Salinger sought out the company of the young. One schoolgirl he befriended even convinced him to do a short interview for the high school paper. In the booth of a local diner, 16-year-old Shirley Blaney conducted what was to be Salinger's last ever interview.
Mr. Salinger is a tall and foreign-looking man of 34. He has an interesting life story and is a very good friend of all the high school students. Mr. Salinger, was The Catcher in the Rye autobiographical?
Sort of. I was much relieved when I finished it. My boyhood was very much the same as that of the boy in the book, and it was a great relief telling people about it.
The majority of his stories were written about people under the age of 21. Many were of characters under the age of 12.
When the article came out, the Claremont Eagle Times realized they had a scoop and ran it on the front page. It was then picked up by newspapers across the country. Salinger's deep sense of betrayal put an abrupt end to his friendship with the students. But soon afterwards, he met 19-year-old Claire Douglas, and 2 years later, they were married.
I never met Claire, but Sid told me why she's just a college girl with a little Peter Pan collar and a cardigan, you know, a cardigan and a Peter Pan collar. And Sid was sort of stunned with this. He couldn't believe that Jerry would have such a young wife. I mean, it just seemed so strange to him. All of his wives apparently were very submissive. But of course, he adored children, and he apparently was wonderful with his children, with Matthew and Peggy.
His marriage to Claire was to last nearly 13 years, but they divorced in 1967, when their son Matthew was 7 years old, and their daughter Peggy, 11. Claire revealed during the divorce proceedings her own intolerance of Salinger's increasing isolation. As his status as best-selling cult author flourished, he retreated further into a private world and was now immersing himself in Eastern religion.
He was a Zen Buddhist. But I think Jerry truly was very involved in religion and with the wonderful idea of everyone having a god within.
Since The Catcher in the Rye, Salinger had begun to explore Eastern religion in his work, which now focused on the emotional life of the Glass family.
The Glass family and the stories that involve them are about, to some degree, what would happen in the 1960s, a spiritual movement, Eastern religion, and a stripping away of ego.
Franny and Zooey came out in 1961, with bookshops reporting queues round the block. It was again about young people who can't fit into the world around them, but who now seek their answers in spirituality.
But with the advent of this new voice, this magnificent literary voice, brand new, never heard before, much like Holden Caulfield in 1951, there came another wave of idolatry for Salinger and another infusion of a certain specific kind of wisdom that led into the 1960s.
This new phase of celebrity created even more press interest. As Salinger began to disappear from public life, journalists became more avid for information. They assumed that if Salinger was in hiding, he must have something to hide.
But one time he was over here in the yard at the parking area at the store, and there was two cornered him. I never knew what he'd done then, but there was two reporters. And they cornered him when he came out to the car. I don't think they probably found out much, but...
In 1961, Time magazine sent an entire team of investigative reporters to look into his private life. It drove Salinger even further underground. For the past 34 years, he has refused to publish any of his work and never talks to the media. Since removing his photograph from dust jackets of his books, few people are even aware of what he looks like. But we discovered that it is possible to find out where he lives.
When you get up to the top, this road will bear this way. And there's actually two ways to get onto this road.
Yeah.
It'll bear off up on the right, and that leads up to his house.
Although Salinger withdrew from public life, here in Cornish, he's often seen around the town.
Well, one thing he did when we had a fire up here on Croydon Mountain, the women cooked food for the firemen, and he organized the young people and had them take the food up there.
But when he goes to the hotel or any place like that to eat, he eats in the kitchen.
We attempted to contact Salinger by letter, but got no response. However, we did speak to some of the many fans who come to leave letters in the mailbox or just walk up the drive. They've become a familiar sight in the nearby town.
I thought, I know where he lives. I could go there. I came up out of the 60s and there were gurus. There was John Lennon and there was Timothy Leary and there was J.D. Salinger. And he was the one that spoke to so many of us and spoke to us with almost a godlike authority.
I saw his silence, his wall of silence that he had built over the years as a kind of invisible work of art. And so I decided, conflicted though I was about it, to drive up to Cornish to see if I could, I don't know, how I'd react.
I was feeling depressed, I guess you'd say, a little probably lonely, maybe a little alienated from society. And I felt, after reading Salinger's works, that he was someone I felt I could relate to.
Well, those people seem to think somebody's going to make everything okay. They must have just identified with certain characters in his books. But they were a nuisance. I mean, they'd come unannounced. Somebody would tell them where he lived. And they'd come up on his deck or his porch and they'd his clothesline. They'd steal his clothes. And they'd be on his deck when he woke up in the morning. He'd, you know, pull the drapes and look at the birds and the view of the mountains in Vermont. And there'd be somebody looking in the window. You know, hi, I'm here.
I was standing there thinking about what to do next when I heard a car start up. This was a furious car, you know, and it kind of saw me and then sped off, spraying mud, and left me feeling regretful that I'd done it.
He told me that many people like me had come over the years. People with problems coming to him to talk with him, people who wanted to communicate, people who wanted an advantage for their career, but he was very frustrated because he didn't know what to tell these people. He said that his writing was fictional. It was not psychoanalytical at all. It was written for entertainment, not psychoanalysis.
And I said, well, are you still writing? He said, well, yes, I'm a writer. That's what I do. And I said, but it's been some time since we've read anything. He said, oh, yes, it has been some time. Words to this effect. But I cannot be rushed. Now, in my thoughts, I'm thinking 13 years. That's his idea of being rushed. And he said, you know, contact with the public hinders my progress. I said, yes, I understand that. And he said, no, you don't understand that, because if you did, you wouldn't be here.
And he got around to, because of the people who had come to see him, he was had some regrets that he'd become a writer. He just was not prepared for the publicity and the attention that he was going to get. I think at one time he called it the insanest profession.
None of these glimpses could tell us what Salinger's life had been for the past 40 years, or who he had become. Yet there was one way in which Salinger was communicating with the outside world. He'd become a prolific letter writer.
He had correspondences, yeah. The only one we really knew about was a gal in England, and he went over there to see her, and I think he was hoping for a future, and it didn't pan out. But other than that, and Joyce.
Joyce Maynard was Salinger's lover, and has only recently decided to speak out. We traveled to San Francisco to hear her story of life with Salinger. She was just 18 when he saw her New York Times cover piece, An 18-Year-Old Looks Back on Life, and wrote to her, offering encouragement and support.
Imagine, at any age, but especially 18, getting a daily letter from Holden Caulfield, essentially that, the same voice that, you know, millions of young readers have fallen in love with, and, you know, that has spoken so keenly to them. Imagine that voice writing just to you, to your little college mailbox, and telling you these great things about yourself. All the rest of my world fell away that spring of 1972.
After an intense correspondence, Joyce moved in with Salinger when she was 19 and he was 53. She found the simple life which he had yearned for in his fiction now taken to an extreme.
We'd get up early and he'd make breakfast, which might be these little frozen tiny peas, bird's eye peas, that he'd put in the sink and run warm water over, and we'd have a bowl of peas often, or maybe some sunflower seeds stirred in with a little honey, maybe some nuts. We'd take a walk. He'd do some yoga. He'd go write. I'd write. It was certainly a life that had a great deal of self-denial built into it. Very little pleasure in food, the most simple foods. One of the goals that he expressed to me from the very beginning, being with him, was, you know, to rid oneself of ego, to leave the considerations of the self behind. I wanted to please him, and I saw the character who pleased him the most, and I wanted to be like her. I want wanted to be like Phoebe. And I didn't name it to myself, but I think I recognized that who I needed to be was young.
It seemed that even in his romantic life, Salinger yearned for the purity embodied in his young female characters, Holden's sister Phoebe as she rides the carousel, or Esme who redeems the young soldier broken by the war.
The photograph of me that had first attracted Jerry Salinger's attention on the cover of the New York Times. And I'm wearing a large watch, a man's watch on my wrist. And when I first met him, the first day I met him, one of the first things he said to me was, "Oh, you're wearing the watch." But months later, over a year later actually, I was reading the story for Esme with Love and Squalor. And there's that just captivating description of that little girl, yet another entrancing little girl. And what is she wearing? A man's watch, a big man's watch. Before I was ever born, I think that was written. It gave me a little shiver, and what it suggested to me was that perhaps I was less loved for myself than I had understood, and that I more closely connected than one likes to believe to just, you know, a character.
If Joyce had been called by letter to Salinger's world to play a character in one of his books, this may well have been a pattern. Many of his courtships had begun with lengthy correspondences.
He liked to go and get his mail every day. That's probably how he connected to the outside world a lot.
I encountered several stories of girls who had correspondences. I met a woman writer, Phyllis Thoreau, who said to me, very lightly in passing, she said, you knew J.D. Salinger. She said, you know, I had an au pair girl who has a packet of letters from J.D. Salinger. You know, I could have dropped to the floor that moment.
Joyce later discovered that the au pair girl, Colleen, had had a correspondence with Salinger when she was 18 and he was 58. A few years later, Colleen had moved in with him and is still there today, apparently at ease with the isolated existence. The details of his life in Cornish suggest a withdrawal not just from the public eye, but from the harsher elements of a world Salinger no longer loves.
It was a very quiet, it was a very lonely life. The truth of it. We watched a lot of television, I have to say. He liked the Andy Griffith Show. It was a portrait of total innocence. And I think he loved that sort of a world of a little North Carolina town with a sheriff who never had any crime to fight. A world that really was fast disappearing.
It seemed that within the four walls of his own home, Salinger could immerse himself in his own world, the fictional characters he loved, and a past where life was simple.
He liked, old big band hits. And we'd dance to the TV. And we watched movies every night. He had a pretty extensive collection of 16mm films. Almost all films from the 30s and 40s. Those were the films that he loved.
But has Salinger turned his back on the modern world in order to create a series of masterpieces, or is he just the world's most prolific letter writer?
Oh, he wrote every day. At least he said he wrote, and I never questioned anything he said. Every morning he put on a blue gabardine mechanics jumpsuit and head into his back room study, and I'd hear the typewriter keys going sometimes.
And he had a seat out of what I think was a Jeep, and he had it on a platform, and that's where he sat and did his typing. It looked very comfortable. When they were building his house, Someplace he found a huge bank safe, and they lowered it in there with a crane. And I wasn't in the safe myself, but I was in the room where the safe is, and it was open. And I think you could have a party in there. And I believe that's where he kept all his manuscripts. I think he said 15 books finished, and he didn't know if he was going to publish them ever.
Well, Jerry's hiding all his work in a huge locked safe. Doesn't that speak to his psyche? I think one of the reasons Jerry's hiding is because if you hide, you don't have to find out. You don't have to figure out what is your voice as an adult now. We've got the voice of the disturbed Holden, of the Glass family, and of Phoebe, and of all these people, but what's the voice of the adult Holden who figured out what drove him crazy and recovered? We've never heard that since 65, and so possibly Jerry doesn't have that voice himself. I don't know.
If he is writing great works of fiction, will he ever feel that the world is worthy of them? Or has his horror at the history of his past work blighted any hope of his ever publishing again?
This was a man who needed to control his universe. And, you know, when you write, you control things utterly as long as they are on your pages. And when those books make their way into all those hundreds of bookstores and those thousands of pairs of readers' hands, you no longer control the response. You can't do that. And the sense was that, you know, you take this, you have this beloved book, these beloved characters. It was almost as if they would not be safe if you sent them out into the world.
Whatever happened in Salinger's own life, the response to his first book may have been enough to prove Holden Caulfield's theory that the adult world is too phony to believe in. And that Salinger's characters were better kept in a safe. Or maybe just in his own imagination.
Maybe he hasn't written anything. And maybe this is all a great hoax. And maybe he hit a writer's block that's just devastated him for 30 years. And he's just sitting up there in his bunkhouse in New Hampshire laughing at all of it, running around trying to resurrect this man, and he doesn't exist. He didn't exist. So that might be a funny ending, wouldn't it?